Good morning. Welcome to the Future Show. My name is Gerd Leonhard. I'm a futurist, and don't worry, the future will not be as dark as the intro. I was just to get you to wake up. So really great pleasure to be here. We have a 50-minute program where we do the Future Show, trying to depict the key trends for the future, and starting with a bit of a future shock and talking about what it could be. And afterwards, we have a great panel discussion right here in the middle. So going into the next session pretty quickly. My new book is Technology versus Humanity. Unfortunately, the box didn't arrive with the books. So if I want to sign your books, I would have to sign your arm or whatever instead. But it's on Amazon, and you can take a look when you have a second. So the thing about the future is that it's actually not about prediction. Right? And sometimes I like to say the future is like a box of chocolates. Before you know it, there's only one left. And this is really important for the discussion today, because the future is something that moves really quickly. And there's a guy that I really admire over the years, Arthur C. Clarke, who was one of the original futurists, along with Alvin Toffler and others. And he talked about how we actually look at the future. Let's check him out for a second, because this will set the stage for what we're going to do later.
Trying to predict the future is a discouraging and hazardous occupation, because the prophet invariably falls between two stools. If his predictions sound at all reasonable, you can be quite sure that in 20 or at most 50 years, the progress of science and technology has made him seem ridiculously conservative. On the other hand, if by some miracle a prophet could describe the future exactly as it was going to take place, his predictions would sound so absurd, so far-fetched, that everybody would laugh him to scorn.
Interesting, this was 1964, and how true that is today. I'm going to ask you actually for the next 2 hours to be unreasonable, right? To be absurd. I mean, think about this for a second. How many things have changed in the last 5 years that we thought of being literally impossible? Right? And how fast technology has actually made the absurd become reality. Right? It's really important that we think about where this is going, where is it taking us. And this is my job, right? This is the job that all of us must do, which is to listen to the future. And spend 5% of your time listening to what's going to be coming beyond the obvious, right? Thinking about a way forward that does not include what is already here. Sometimes I like to say we have to assume less and discover more. You know, I used to be in the music business, and the music business, a long time ago, you know, we sold records, and all of a sudden the internet came up. You remember Napster in those days, right? And now the entire music business is in the cloud, right? And the assumption of the music business was that you sell music by the copy, right? You sell units. Well, too bad, because today, you know, Spotify also, as you know, is like 10 euros for 18 million songs, right? We're no longer selling music by the unit. And the same is happening in the car business and the financial industry. If we question our assumptions, we can be safe to create our future. This is a key point, especially, I think, here in Switzerland, where we're trying to avoid all risk. And sometimes I say avoiding all risk is the biggest risk. So it's something we should contemplate on. So just assume less, discover more, and see where that is going to take us. Now, the transition that is ahead is something that we all are aware of. You know, if we're looking already at our reality, our mobile devices are already our external brains. We keep information in there, we store our contacts, we forget phone numbers of loved ones, we look up our stock market information, we trade on the mobile phone, and we're essentially outsourcing part of our brain to a device. And in this sort of evolution, we're going, you know, we're here where we can recognize ourselves, you know, falling into the fountain or into the lake in Lucerne. Lots of people fall into the lake every day because they're doing this, right? Walking, you may remember how that works, right? And then wearable computing, where all of a sudden we can connect directly to the internet, and then being able to actually supplement ourselves and augment ourselves by becoming cyborgs. And ultimately the destination of humanity, this is a question I have for you. If you're European, you have a different answer, right? Are we going to go connect directly to the internet with brain-computer interface? Sounds like science fiction, right? It's not. Entirely possible, roughly in 10 years, to do that. What's called the second neocortex, right? connecting directly to the internet. Imagine if that happens, you know, how quickly you can transact with money, because there wouldn't be any interface, any typing, right? So, but the question is, how far should we take this? Should we build tool makers? You know, these are tools on the left side. On the right side, do we become a tool? And that's why I like to say humanity will change more in the next 20 years than the previous 300 years. It's hard to imagine, right? Because the previous 300 years had the Industrial Revolution and wars, right? But your kids are very likely going to live in a world where they won't even know ever how to drive a car without a computer driving it, to drive it themselves. They will not know CDs. They will not know books. Right? The kids of your kids, right? Take a bit more time. We're going to be living in a world where we may be looking at the end of dying, right? The possibility of living to be 150. I mean, again, science fiction, dying probably, yes. But all of our kids of our kids will live to be 100 in average, right? It's already kind of certain. So in this world, right, we had to think about what the future actually holds. And here's what I'm telling you right in the beginning. The future is better than you think. When we hear look about the future, we think about all the movies that we've watched in the past, right? And the facts are, however, the reality is already much better than we thought. Global life expectancy is increasing to a tremendous level. Right? We're moving into a world where all of these things are becoming possible in a way that wasn't possible before, right? Mortality is decreasing of infants. Poverty is decreasing. Right? All of these things are positive things that have already happened. And when you talk about this, everybody's saying like, oh, I didn't know, but we're actually getting better, right? It seems we're getting worse. So world literacy rate is up. Right? These are all things that are happening because of technology, because of possibilities. And computing costs are declining rapidly in a way that we had anticipated, of course, Moore's law. Right? So transaction costs, bandwidth costs declining, business models change because of this, because people are getting connected, right? These two curves, costs and benefits increasing, that's obviously a scenario that's really going to make a lot of things possible, increases GDP. The possibility of genome sequencing, right? Mind-boggling, now it's going to be $800. In 10 years, it'll be cheaper to do the genome sequencing than to flush the toilet, right? And mind-boggling changes that will come from this, and also the solar energy actually happening now. Right? I mean, it's talked about this forever, and best of all, world population growth is slowing. Well, it's still going to be 10 billion people, which is a lot, right? But it's not growing as fast as we thought it would. Right? So the future is actually brighter than we think, and the key question really is about technology. Is no longer going to be if technology can do something, but why. And this is going to be your question when you're looking at your institutions. Basically, anything you want to do will be possible in the next 10 years. All the stuff that we've seen already has already moved in this direction, but now the key question is really about something like this. The future is not just something that happens tomorrow. It is something that already happened today, and we haven't noticed. Now I'd like to know what you think about the future. So please take out your mobiles. And this is a session where you actually get to do it, you know, without looking rude. Take out your mobile devices, your weapons. Yeah, it's fine. You can take them out. You don't have to hide them. Yes. So this is the audience participation part. It's a very simple website called minty.com. It's on the screen. It's a total simple poll. You go to menti.com, don't sign up, don't download, don't share your location, okay? Just let us know what you think about the future. Pick from the options. You can only pick one option, okay? And hit the submit button. Now, I know there's about 150 people in this room. If I don't see as many responses, then you're significantly challenged by technology. That does not bode well for your future. So keep voting, right? I want to know how you feel about the future. Whether you are challenged by technology or ecstatic or optimistic or you feel dystopian about this. You can only vote once. We have three of those sessions today, so keep your weapons ready. Okay, and for the next session, you have to refresh to actually do the next poll. Right? Okay. Keep voting, that's very interesting. I guess this is why you're at SIBOS, because you feel optimistic about the future, or maybe vice versa. Maybe SIBOS will make you feel optimistic. Very interesting result. You can keep voting, right? The PIN code is 417103. We'll leave this running in the background. Okay. Great to see that you feel good about the future. So do I. I think we're pretty much in the same direction about this. So now we get to the most important slide of the day, and I hope you don't have nightmares about this later tonight, but, well, it's actually a positive nightmare, I suppose. So exponentiality, right? You know what that means is that our world is not progressing linearly anymore. And when you count linear, you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. When you count exponential, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, Moore's law, Metcalfe's law, right? You heard about these things. Reality is we're at the takeoff point of an exponential curve. Everything that we thought was impossible is indeed becoming possible. And that changes our business, our culture, our society. And we're at point four, right? The next step is eight. That's roughly 16 to 18 months. If we go 7 years, we're on 128. If we go 30 steps, we're at a billion. Right? Now think about this for a second. 30 steps exponential, maybe 50 years. Right? It's a vertical curve of chain. Right? The things we're going to see in 30 years are incomprehensible today. Right? We can't even picture it. Machines that can think, artificial intelligence, right? Robotics, automation. Some people are saying we're going to lose up to 65% of all jobs based on automation. Is that a good news or bad news? I don't know. You will discuss that, right? Hopefully they will not be in banking. No, just kidding, they will be. But we'll discuss what that means, right? And what our options are. And just as an important fact, I think it's really important for us to say technology is not a savior. Okay? Technology can be a saving point in your business, and that's why we're talking about it, but it will not save your business if the model is bad. Right? We'll talk more about what that means and where that's going. But in this curve that you've just seen, wait and see means wait to die. It's a very strange thing to say in Switzerland, right? I mean, I'm from Germany originally, but I live in Switzerland. And waiting and seeing is very difficult in an exponential world because you're always late, and then you're really late, and then you're totally late, and then you're dead, right? Because it's exponential. So in this curve, we're facing this one challenge, I think, every day, and that's this, right? People are linear. We don't improve exponentially. We cannot store more memory right now. We don't have more friends because we have Facebook. We don't have more time. We don't get more sleep just because we use technology. The opposite. Technology is exponential. Humans are linear. And you know what companies are saying now? Many companies I work with, they're saying essentially, humans are expensive. Technology is getting cheaper. So you know what that means, right? Use more technology, use less humans. And this is a discussion, of course, that's raging around the world. What do we do with this? If you're my age and you've worked in a job, say, 20 years, and all of a sudden a machine comes and says, you know what, it's complicated, but I figured out what you're doing. Right? Like IBM Watson using analytics to figure out medical records. Right? So now we're moving into a world that if we continue to imagine our future in a linear way, we may have catastrophic results. We may actually think about the scale and the speed in an entirely different way. So one of the themes of my work and in my book is this thing that science fiction is becoming science fact. And in many ways, you can say that is a good thing, for example, the science fiction of curing cancer. Right? I mean, that would be amazing if we can do that, and I think we can eventually. The science fiction of having enough water for everyone, desalination. That's science fiction, but it's happening. Abundant energy through solar and renewable is going to happen in 20 years. Right? Abundant energy. Again, sound like science fiction, but here's another science fiction. Artificial intelligence is contributing to the change of society 10 times as fast and 300 times the scale of the Industrial Revolution. That's 3,000 times the scale. Right? That we're seeing because of artificial intelligence. Yeah. It's very important for us to think about what that means for our work. Yeah. Because now this is a new mantra, right? Change is happening gradually, then suddenly. Yeah. In other words, we don't see much and we think it's not happening. and boom, it's there. I mean, think about the self-driving car. We talked about the self-driving car and electric cars for 50 years, right? The first electric car was in the 30s, and it didn't happen. We thought about machines that can think 5 or 6 times in artificial intelligence, right? Didn't happen. Just because something didn't happen the first time does not mean it will not happen this time. It's a very important lesson to learn. Right? It's gradually, then suddenly, it's basically not at all, and then boom, it takes off. So if you think that you're safe, think again. It feels very safe because you're making still a lot of money. Right? You're doing quite well. But the change that comes is gradually, then all of a sudden, in a giant curve. Right? And you can see what happened in the music business, the media business, the publishing business. That's what's going to happen to banking in a more positive way, I hope, right? Because we're here today tackling the future. So in terms of what the future brings, there's a bunch of things I want to show you. I want to skip the translation demo because I don't have my mobile, but things have become science fiction, actually have become science fact. Let's show some examples of this. We have a video clip queued up with 5 things.
But what about tulips? Great. So some beautiful arrangements here. Knows where my mother lives, seamlessly puts all that together, and we'll go ahead and buy that. And that's it. The flowers are on the way.
It's been 2 weeks since the last time you called your mom. Don't you miss her? Maybe it's time to stop quarreling with each other.
Fabia, call my mom.
Yes.
With his artificial intelligence, Pillow recognizes each and every member of your family and starts caring for them.
Clara, here are your cholesterol pills. I see you're running low. Shall I reorder them for you?
Thank you, Pillow. That'd be great.
Can you hear me in French?
Pouvez-vous me entendre en français?
Oui! Je peux en parler français?
Yes, I can hear you talk French. But this is awesome. But how you do it?
Yeah, it's translating.
New ways to visualize our work.
I have an idea for the fuel tank.
New ways to share ideas with each other.
Okay, Google, how's the traffic from Pebble Rock School to the airport?
Your normal route has heavy traffic. There's a faster one that'll take about 35 minutes. I've sent it to your phone.
Okay.
Yeah, talking about science fiction, science fact, there's thousands of those kind of things, right? And when you watch these movies like Pillow, you can say, this is not real. This is actually not working, right? It turns out it is working, and people are doing this. 3 million U.S. users have Amazon Echo in their living room listening to everything that they're saying. We probably wouldn't do that in Switzerland, but let's think about what that means. Right? Basically, this is a huge tidal shift. And trillions of dollars are invested in changing our behavior. God knows what's next. You know, you can speak to Pillow and say, you know, find the right woman to get married, you know, and it will go off and acquire it, I suppose. But underlying all these seeds is a clear thing that's happening with the internet, right, is that everything is becoming connected. Being here in Switzerland, I use a central theme, that is the cow, right, is even the cows are getting connected, and that's literally true. Because we want to find out how they've been eating, their mating behavior, you know, maybe we can get them to be intelligent as well. But clearly this is a syndrome. There will not be a single thing in the world left that is not connected, right? Logistics and cars and airplanes and cargo ships and spare parts and, right? And that is going to create new business models that are unheard of. But it's also going to create a giant vortex of information that who actually is in charge of it? I mean, it doesn't matter for the cows, obviously. They're going to end up in the slaughterhouse anyway. But what about us? Right? Clearly, the Internet of Things is what I call the land of milk and money. Right? We have to think about where we're going and what does it do. All these trends are actually converging. Right? They're combinatorial. I mean, they're not just one thing happening. They're like 50 things happening at the same time. And this is the central thing that's happening. Right? This is the most central thing that's happening, the convergence of man, woman, and machine. When I say man, I talk about all of us, right? That's just the term, right? Human. So this convergence is now with us. If you're my age, you think, okay, that's kind of a strange thing. You get used to it, right? If you're 15, this sounds completely normal to you. And the kids of the 15 years old, they will not exist without that. You know, right now we feel lonely without our mobile device. Maybe in 10 years we won't even get up, we won't even start our systems without being connected to the network. I mean, clearly this is a huge change, you know, and basically it's creating a giant technological vortex, right, that is kind of like this. Power, right? The power of technology. The attraction of technology. Cheaper, more powerful, more useful, right? More omnipresent. There'll be 6.5 billion people connected to the internet by 2020. And about 78% by 2025. There won't be a single place left, including the Swiss Alps, where that's already the case, right? Where you cannot go on the internet. This vortex is extremely powerful. And I would submit to you right now, 90% of that is a good thing. Right? For example, being able to talk on messaging apps for free with our kids. Right? But the rest of it is creating also a kind of addiction. Right? And also creating a wormhole, right? For example, you can do things like use Tinder for dating, so you don't have to bother with real dating, you just swipe, right? It's creating a shortcut, a simulation, right? Creating things that we thought we would do in person. You know, the world famous psychologist Daniel Kahneman once said that cognition, you know, understanding, is embodied. Right? We don't think with the brain, we think with the body. If we use technology to think, we're obviously not going to use the body for the time being. Are we missing something, right? Where are we going? What is the wormhole as a default? So I want to talk to you about a bunch of shifts that are happening around this wormhole society. I think you're probably aware of those. And there's a major chapter in my book on this, and that's actually available online. And so here are the keywords, a little bit, quite a few of them, so I'll try not to make it too scholarly here, but digitization is something that all of us know about. We don't have to talk much about that, right? But the next one, mobilization, right, essentially means that everything that is digital is becoming mobile. Computing is no longer on the desktop. You know that, but the next destination of mobile is to just be in the cloud. So I just speak to the computer. I don't actually have a mobile. I just speak to it. Mobilization, screenification. Everything that used to be in writing is a screen now. It's mediated, that we use to swipe or have access to information. And most importantly for your businesses, datafication. Everything that used to not be connected, transactions, conversations, like when you go to the doctor scribbles down what you have and puts it in some file, that's all digital now, right? Your device is talking to the doctor, your diagnoses are in the cloud. Datafication is a major trend, and it leads to the next one, which is intelligization. Not a real word, but making things intelligent. Right? In the business of banking and financial, if you can datafy and make intelligent, right, that's half the rent. Because that creates whole new opportunities. And that brings also this, right? This is a good and a bad thing, right? Nobody wants to be automated. None of us want to be automated away. As a futurist, I face this thing every day, where now I see companies inventing what I call the future bot, right? Is you can speak to a computer and ask them about the future, you'll get an answer. You check out IBM Watson, right? So I'm being automated. Just give me another year and I'll be just a bot standing here. Disintermediation, this is of course your problem. Right? There's so many people using technology just to eat little pieces of what you used to do. And every day there's a new entity eating another little piece. If you want to know about disintermediation, look no further than Airbnb. Right? What happened there, you know, coming into the back door. This is a crucial thing. When once we know this, we can move on and think about what the next thing is. Right? Basically, from here, we go to virtualization. All the stuff that used to be physical is now in the cloud. Music in the cloud, films in the cloud, medical records in the cloud, money in the cloud, cars in the cloud, becoming virtualized, like software-defined networking. Prediction. We've always thought that computers can do this, but now they really can. Give it 5 more years when we have supercomputers, we can come to a place where computers can predict the social security spending in the next 5 years on a pretty accurate level. or unemployment, things like that. So it's a mind-boggling change. Very important for us, if you understand the mega shifts, you can futurize your business. You can think about what impact that will have on your business. The first thing about changing your business is not to buy more technology. It's to understand those changes that are coming and then invest in the right technology. This is the bottom line of one of those things, is that really it's been said for 15 years, if you haven't seen this, then you've probably lived in Antarctica or something. Data is the new oil. And data is the power of the world. There's only one currency that matters, or two currencies really, is data and trust. If you're looking at this slide, it's a little bit hard to see on here. On the left, 2006, the most powerful companies in the world were oil companies and some banks. You know, there's one lonely bank in this group of market caps. Just 10 years later, the oil companies are still here, of course. I still have seen them somewhere, but they're declining in importance. And it's the tech companies who are running the world, right? Apple, Alphabet, that's of course Google. And right underneath this, make no mistake about this, these are not just Americans. The next strain of this, 25 Chinese companies. Alibaba, Baidu, and so on, right? The power in the world is shifting, right, to those companies. And here's a key question I have for you. We regulated oil heavily, and it still was a problem. We regulated nuclear, and it was still a problem. We're not regulating data. We're not actually anywhere close to regulating those technology companies and data companies. Should we or should we not? I'm not going to answer that question. I'll leave that to you. It's a 5-minute conversation. Just kidding. So the important thing that's happening today, however, is that as we move forward, it's important to realize what the disruption factors are. And here's four of them. And I would say before I start with this, the financial industry fills every one of those four factors. Complex environments where you have regulation, you have confusion, you don't know what people are doing, you don't have transparency. You have trust issues. After the financial crisis, clearly, banks are the least trusted. It's getting a little bit better now, but for a while, there was a huge trust crisis. You have obsolete intermediaries, like a music publisher, right, or a record label. I mean, does any artist still sign with a record label? You just go on YouTube, right? I mean, we'll have an artist later tonight. She is independent. She's not with a record label. That would have been unheard of. Last one is restricted access. That's information that you have that the client does not. As soon as you have artificial intelligence, the client walks to the machine and says, show me asset management possibilities for 10,000 euros in real-time performance every 10 seconds, and the engine will invest it for you. It may not be good enough yet, but clearly we're heading onto a world where those things are becoming a wave, a tidal wave of change. You've noticed a tidal wave of change in the past, right? The music business, the e-commerce business, media, phone calls. I mean, if you're a telecom company, phone calls are totally a commodity, right? And everything you do is becoming a commodity, so what do you do then? The car company is right on top of that wave right now. It's amazing to see how in 6 years, the most important thing for car companies is not to sell cars, but to sell mobility. Mercedes-Benz just announced a couple of weeks ago at an event where I spoke that they are shifting from selling units to selling services. I mean, think about that for a second, right? This is a mind-boggling change. And you're in the same loop, right? This wave is going to continue. Education, banking, medical, insurance, food, government, and military. 80% of military spending in 10 years will be cyber, security, cloud, all that stuff that is essentially virtual. So it's no longer the topic of saying that, you know, it's really important to disrupt stuff. I mean, you've seen the recent wave a few years ago about the so-called unicorns, right? The companies that are funded for $1 billion of private money. Their primary motivation was disruption. Well, it's quite obvious now, it's not enough to disrupt, right? I mean, as you can see about the current debates about Uber and Airbnb and hundreds of other companies, it's not enough to have a mind-boggling changing idea and just skin the cream off the top. You have to actually create an ecosystem. You have to actually make sense. And this is your opportunity as an incumbent if you work for an incumbent company. Right? Construction is something that you know. So if you're UBS, or if you're an oil company or a record label, right? And this is really what that means. This is the shift of value we're seeing in society from selling commodities to making goods to delivering services to creating experiences. Now think about that for a second. The most important company in the world today, the tech companies, this is what they do, right? They create an experience. I mean, Facebook owns no media. Airbnb doesn't own any rooms. Uber doesn't own any cars. All they do is create an experience, partly virtual experience. So this is the key for the future, I think, of the financial industry. Stage experiences. And you know what that means? It does not mean using fancy technology. Yes, of course, that's part of it, right? It means creating human experiences. Value, trust, relationships. And have technology support this. So basically what we're seeing here is this giant change in the towards the experience economy that has been predicted for years, and it's finally happening. So in this world, this is what's happening all around us. Again, it looks a little bit dystopian, but there's many good things about it, and we figured we would shake you up a little bit before you go back into the lull of checking your Blackberries. We're moving into a world that is essentially creating what I call a global brain. This world has every single point of information about you, right? Your browse, your history, your mobile devices, your medical records, your driving records, what you've purchased. And when digital money comes, right, this cloud will just explode. Because right? Everything is collected in this cloud. Whatever can be automated will be automated. Things are mind-boggling shifts into where we are going with this, how business is changing. And we may ask the question, is this just going to be big brain or big brother? How do we make sure that the global brain is not the global big brother? We'll talk about that in the panel later. Right? Clearly, if you were intent to become the owner of the global brain, there's about 15 companies who are shooting for this. In fact, Google has a project called the global brain. Right? There's 15 companies who want to do this. Can we trust them? Right? Who are they? I mean, look at this, the exponential growth of computing possibilities. Right? In 2050, we'll have one computer that has the capacity of all human brains. All human brains. Right now we have one or two computers, one is in China, one is in the US, and one is in CERN, I think, that has the capacity of one human brain. Roughly 20 quadrillion calculations per second. Computer costs $1 trillion and takes up the entire power of the city of Geneva, right? But this is the exponential curve. Quantum computing, have you heard about this? Is going to mind-boggling change. And so what's happening here is that as we're moving on this curve, we're getting to a point that's sometimes referred to as a singularity. The point of where a machine can match human capacity. We're not talking about emotional capacity, right? We're talking about processing. And this is a very minor part of what we are doing, actually. But let's think about that as being equivalent to the brain. So that is roughly 10 years away. In 10 years, computers can do what we are doing today. Right now, a computer can beat the world champion in Go, but it cannot talk to a two-year-old, because it's unstructured. In just 2 years, we're going to have language translation in 50 languages, like the demo showed, in a way of saying that we are live translating. So here's the key question for us. Do you think we should go to a place where we transcend what we are? I think it's much more important to go to this place that I call exponential humanism. We are going to need to embrace exponential technology. There's no way back, right? If we don't embrace technology, we become uncompetitive, we become slow, and then you can move to Amish country if you want to do that, right? It's not going to, we can't disconnect. We cannot not be part of that. And we cannot say we will not use computers that can think, right? That would be like saying we don't want to use the telephone. But to create a balance of this, also a brand and a purpose, right? How about being exponentially human? Why do you think your customers come to you? Do they come to you because you have a fancy app or a great database or yeah, your CIO is a great guy? They come to you because of relationships. The marriage of relationships and technology is really what we're after. And that's ultimately what some of the new companies don't have, right? They're working on that very hard, and they may actually get to it, but this is really important. So technology can be both heaven or hell. And this is important to realize that what we're doing right now is we're creating technologies that have mind-boggling positive potential, solving global problems, making transactions cheaper, making a lot of us very rich, but we also can create technology that can be destructive to us. For example, today, a lot of kids are on Facebook, well, it's no longer kids, it's people between 30 and 50, we still call them kids, right? But political action means going to Facebook and pushing a like button on something, right? That's political action? Not really. Right? You would say that's interesting, but that's really quite different than actually doing something. So technology replaces sometimes things that we should be doing. And certainly if you think about computers that can think about this for a second, right? If we get to the point where we have computers doing this, we may have computers with an IQ of 50,000. We may then have computers with an IQ of 5 million. Right? Imagine that machine would run your bank. Well, in a sense of being the new chief machine officer, I suppose, right? It's really about stewardship. Right? We have to figure out how we're going to run this. Who is in charge? What are the rules? It cannot just be open for everyone. And certainly we cannot let US regulation dictate what we do around the world. Right? I mean, right now 95% of this is actually made in the US, right? So what does it mean for us here and for the rest of the world? It's hell then, right? Hell and heaven. And I would propose to you that you think about the future as trying to maximize the hell and maximize the heaven. Yeah, that's a good one. That's a Freudian mistake, a German mistake. So this is a very important topic for us, right? The temptation of technology. The temptation is to say everything that we can automate, we will automate because we can fire 90% of people. If you run call centers, you're going to fire 90% of people because call centers can be automated. As soon as computers understand language, it's over. That's 2 years away. We're talking about 40 million jobs here. Right? 23 million truck drivers in the US. Right? Not all of them will go, but most of them. Accountants. Accounting, you mean, you know, numbering things and figuring, yes, you can automate that. But here's the key question, right? I mean, in the end, this temptation also means that we can get to a point where a company of 100,000 people all of a sudden has 5,000 people and the same revenues. So the question really is, what should be automated? What should not be automated? We shouldn't ask the question in the next board meeting, what can we automate and virtualize, but also the question, what shouldn't we automate? And here's one key message on this, and customer happiness cannot be automated. You cannot automate the most important things in our lives, right? Relationships, trust, happiness, the things that we don't even know how to put into an algorithm, right? We still don't know how we have emotions in terms of biology. And this is the trend that drives it, right? Now we have machines that can do what's called cognitive computing. Lots of companies working on this, IBM being the most well-known one. If you have a second, go to YouTube and watch the IBM videos featuring Bob Dylan about artificial intelligence. I don't know how they got him to do that, but it's a great video. In this world, right, all of a sudden, we face a situation where algorithms are right next to what I call andro-rhythms, right? This is an artificial world, but keep this in mind. The future of business is really two things, right? Technology, algorithms, machine learning, all the stuff that we're doing now, big data, cloud computing, and this, right? Human purpose, brand, connection, responsibility, empathy, compassion. Right? Things that computers will never understand, at least for the foreseeable future. They may understand it, but they can't be it. Right? There's a very big difference there. So it's very important to master both. If you have kids, you think about this for a second. You don't want your kids to be tech people only, unless they're brilliant Nobel Prize winners, because tech will be automated. If you're in the pharma business, you're already using a tool called cloud biology, right? Which is taking the lab and putting it into the cloud and running simulations of labs. Right? So if you're a programmer, just a few years from now, it's the machine that will program itself. So understanding people is a crucial thing for the future, right? Mastering that we have to use technology as a tool, right? Not as a purpose. The purpose is what we have over here. So there's a new trend that you've seen all around is intelligent digital assistants is the main topic in this conference, right? I call them IDAs. And they're popping up left and right. Here's the big thing about this, right? If you think that we're going to use websites and apps for a long time, you're seriously mistaken, because what is happening right now is that we're going to start talking to computers because it is actually working. I already talked to my computer to dictate emails. Some of you may do that already. It's only roughly 2 years away. In 5 years, most of us will not type. We will not use apps. We're going to speak to whatever box there is and say, figure out how to invest my 20,000 euros. Book me a flight to Miami, because this bot knows everything there is about you, literally like Amazon Echo, right? Observing you. That could be a nightmare or it could be a good thing, but this is essentially a way where you could say, if you wanted to be ironic, you could say that the machines will kind of live for us, right? A strange view of the world where we'll discuss that in the panel of where that is going to take us. Do you want to live in a world like this, where these bots and intelligent assistants go deep diving in your brain? And that's really what they're doing. If you use Siri and Cortana or Amazon Echo or Google Home, that's what they're doing, right? They're going inside of your head fishing. Fishing to what to sell you. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. It's just a question of who would you actually want to go deep diving in your brain? Right? Who will you, and what are they liable for? Right now, there is no liability. Whatever can be done is being done, right? This is a huge issue. We have to think about where that's taken us. Or are you ready to augment yourself? Are you ready to enter a world where you say, you know what? It's so great, I wish I could connect and have more processing capability. It's like the Viagra of the mind, right? It's always on, creating a digital copy of ourselves. Obviously extremely convenient, but are we still going to be people if we do this? Should we transcend humanity? Let me ask you a simple question. If tomorrow you are able to use a technology to increase your IQ so you can work faster, right, would you use it? I mean, people are doing that today using drugs, right? So-called nootropics, right? Drugs that can beef up your performance, like caffeine, but better, right? I think if we think about using technology to amplify ourselves, at a certain point, it's not an upgrade, it's a downgrade. Because we're going to lose things that we actually want to keep, like mystery, surprise, accidents, mistakes, lying, right? I mean, lying is a bad thing, but it's human nature that we lie. Do you want to take that away because it's inefficient? Right? I'm not entirely sure, right? It is time for sort of a tribal powwow on this future, where it's going. Right? And in this future that has been depicted in Minority Report, I mean, do we want to live in such a future where everything is just a download? Right? Sometimes I say, you know, we weren't downloaded, we were born. There are people who want to change that, in fact. So these are all things happening all around us. So we're going to take a little poll, and you get to use your mobiles again. And okay, this is a very important question for your business, because you're going to ask people to augment themselves, right? So let's go back to menti.com. If you used it before, if you're not inept on using a mobile smartphone and you've used it before, that's fantastic. Refresh the page, put in the code 176093, and just really quick give me a response How do you feel about man-machine converging? Does it make you worried? Does it make you feel scared? Where exactly is it going? Wow, there must be quite a few people here from Silicon Valley. It's inevitable. Okay, very good. We have an interesting fragmentation here. But I can see I already brainwashed you by saying we should embrace technology but not become it. Keep voting, you're doing the right thing. Okay. You know, it's very interesting. If I do this in America, all the response on the left side. Right? It's inevitable, we're going to do it. If I do it in Switzerland only with Swiss people, it's all on the right side. I will not talk about Germany, we'll leave that out for a second, right? But it's an interesting mix, right? How do you feel about man-machine converging? We'll keep this running, keep voting, okay? The whole thing is up and running while we're talking. Just remember this, where it's going. So here's the challenge in our world, right? Technology is magic. I mean, I love magic technology. And I can't remember the first time I got a BlackBerry, I was thinking like, oh God, now I can actually leave AOL, right? And get my emails on the beach in Phuket. That's fantastic. My wife hated it, but I still used it. But this is the key word in all keynotes. If you listen to Steve Jobs, every second sentence, right? And it's true. Magic technology being able to affording us things that we were literally not able to do before. And then sometimes becoming manic, you know, like we would feel like we're not complete without that technology. We wake up in the middle of the night and we make a Facebook update, right? That is kind of manic. You know, sitting around the table and twittering to each other instead of talking, we twitter to each other, right? And the next thing is technology is becoming toxic in many ways, right? Polluting our relationships. For example, if we do things on Facebook that are between friends, and all of a sudden they have a much wider audience, including our employer, right? That is a toxic effect. If we get fired because there's a people analytics engine, right? Some of you may know about people analytics, an HR tool, that filters all of our activities and says, this person is dispensable, right? Based on their tweets and their LinkedIn posts. Or if we have drones that can kill people without human supervision. There's only two countries in the world that are proposing for this to be okay. The US and the UK. And of course they make them, this is why it should not be forbidden, right? But this is a toxic use of technology. Allowing a drone to decide if the 4-year-old girl is an enemy or not is bad enough if a person has to decide that, right? But this is a huge thing of really changing our world. Just imagine once we have augmented reality and virtual reality, we're going to live inside of this world. We're going to evaporate in this world. Right? Magic, manic, toxic. We should not allow technology providers and technologies to create too many toxic effects. We need to make them responsible, just like the gun manufacturers are responsible for the use of a gun and the availability of a gun, right? Guns don't kill people, people kill people. Same thing, right? We have to think about what that means for us. We're moving into a world where we're completely surrounded by technology. Should there be liability? Should there be understanding of the context? This is changing our society so dramatically, we won't even know who we are in 10 years. And it also has great potential. So we really need to think about leaving room for human inefficiency. Imagine you live in a world where you can't smoke a cigar because it would be public record that you did. Where you don't get insurance because you drive too aggressively. Where what you say on Facebook gets you barred for immigration. That's already the case, right? I mean, that world is a world that we probably don't want to live in. So how do we remain human? How do we not forget ourselves? Where do we go from here? Do we go to this world, right? I mean, it is interesting that people have been suggesting that we're becoming as God. You know, I'm not religious, but we have superpower now. All of you have literally superpower. Now today on the smartphone, you have more processing power than the president of the US 20 years ago. In a smartphone. You know, Marc Andreessen, the famous entrepreneur, said that software is eating the world in 2011, and it's very true, right? Everything around us has become software. And that's the whole debate of this event, right? When things become software, when money becomes software, what do? But now, maybe software is also cheating the world, right? Telling us things that really aren't entirely true because it's not good enough. I'll give you the TripAdvisor example. You guys use TripAdvisor? If you only go where TripAdvisor tells you, you are in deep trouble. TripAdvisor is a fantastic tool. I use it all the time. It does good things, right? But it's not the reality. It's a slice of reality. And the same is true for data. It's very important to keep that in mind. How do we do this? Where do we go from here? How do we do this? And the most important topic of this is happiness. Think about this for a second. Can technology make us happy? Can we have technology that is essentially an app for happiness? I mean, it's interesting to see that there's about 47 divorce apps on the iStore. You can actually use an app to get divorced if you're unhappy, right? So technology says it can do all the things, but Einstein already said if we measure the wrong thing, we do the wrong thing. We have to be very careful with this because, like the Tesla self-driving car, lots of things can go wrong. We can't act it like it's a person. It's a little bit like GDP, gross domestic product. Bobby Kennedy already said in the 60s, GDP measures everything except that which makes life worthwhile. So when you think about happiness, how do we measure happiness? How do we go to a combination of what in Bhutan is called gross national happiness? You think about your customers, you want them to be gross national happy with you, and not just buy stuff. This is a much more complex thing than technology does. So basically this forces us to consider what is happening, what I call digital ethics. Those two things. And you, every day in your jobs, you have to balance those two things. Here's the bottom line. Technology does not have ethics. It doesn't give a damn about our morals, our ethics, our collective culture. Whatever you had in mind, it can understand that stuff because we can find out that you're angry, for example, right? But it doesn't care. It's an engine. It's zeros and ones, right? And maybe some technology will eventually be able to replicate this from us. But technology cannot exist. It cannot be like we do, right? So technology has no ethics, but imagine a society without ethics. And I'm not talking about religion, right? I'm talking about ethics, the bottom line human understanding. The Dalai Lama said that ethics is much more important than religion. And this is really what we have to think about. The cards that we have on the table, the human cards, right? They're the same cards than 10,000 years ago. But technology is adding new cards every single day. Right? It's adding new cards that are giving us a possibility of being overrun by technology. So digital ethics is a key term. And so the question I have for you when you're looking at the future, which way are you going to go? Are you going to be on what I call Team Robot, right? Which is using technology to substitute people? Are you going to be on Team Human, where you sit on top of technology? That's a key question. What do you think will make the most money? Well, some companies would argue that, of course, being Team Robot makes most money. That's a question we have to answer. I think it's a bad idea, but in terms of monetization, and maybe it's a mix of the two, it's not black or white, of course, right? But are you on Team Human? Is what you're proposing to your customer, is that based on being on Team Human? Which way are you going in this new world where you're going into a city, right? And one way you're going to Algo Town and the other one you're going to, you make those decisions every single day. And of course, the reality is it's not black or white. It's a complete mix at all times, right? We do have to think about what that means. And basically thinking about putting inside, our proposal, putting inside a way of thinking as a humanity that is inside rather than technology. In the old days, you'd have a sticker that said, what is inside, Intel inside, and today it's going to be about this, right? It's going to be about, are you actually still human? Do you have a brand? Do you have a purpose? Do you stand for something? Are you responsible? And that is ultimately our value proposition. If you can take technology and put human inside, on human on top, right? you go in the right directions. So I have a brief summary, and then we're going to move on to our panel because we're already a little bit late here. But four key points that I want to propose for discussion. Point number one, really a very simple one. You know, we really do have to have a public debate about what we're doing here. How far do we allow technology to proceed? Who's in charge? That's why we're doing this, right? This whole discussion about the things that, we're going to deliver and the things that where we are going and so on, right? And the basic income guarantee that we voted on here in Switzerland, in 20 years, we may very well find ourselves out of work because technology and computers are doing the work for us. I don't know, that's a really tough one, right? That's sort of post-capitalism, you could say. That is a tough debate. It was actually not voted for here in Switzerland. We need understanding on ethics. What do we agree on? Right? Sometimes I say we need an environment protection agency for humanity, you know, an EPA for humanity, protecting what we stand for. And we're going to have to figure out, just like nuclear energy, right, what is the point about artificial superintelligence? Where does it go? It's as powerful as nuclear. Right? There's many debates about this. We need a non-proliferation agreement. We need to move forward to a way where this allows us to actually do this and think about this. Okay, let's move forward. We're going to go to our debate where very soon we have a short summary and then we're going forward. So here's a new poll. That's the final poll. Okay, this is a little bit more intricate. We're giving more. You can come in if you want. We can give you some more feedback here. Basically, on this poll, menti.com, you have a choice of 1 to 10. 1 is that you don't agree at all, and 10 is you agree a lot. And we're summarizing the statements of today's show. Okay? So if you don't agree at all, just leave it on 1 and go all the way down and then submit. Okay? Indicate your opinion on each of those options. Okay? And just relax with the music for a little bit and let us know what you think before I tell you what I think, which I'm very good at. Okay, are you in there? Don't give up on the voting. There you go. Very good. We're going to see if we can publish those on Twitter later so you can see what people have actually thought of, okay? And keep voting on this. It's quite interesting to see the results, and we'll post them on Twitter because we're a little bit out of time now. Let me paraphrase what I think is most important. Right? We're on the pivot point of an exponential evolution. We're at the takeoff point. Right? We're going to change more in the next 20 years than the previous 100 years. Technology should not be what we seek, but how we seek. Because it doesn't have ethics, but we depend on it. In terms of all of these things happening, the speed is mind-boggling. So it's really, really important, right, to figure out who is mission control for humanity. Or should there be a mission control for humanity? So the future is technology, but we may want to think about transcending it from algorithms to what are called andro-rhythms and the qualities that actually do make us human. Important summary of the day is embrace technology, but don't become it. That's my key message, and that's why you're here, to embrace technology. In this future, I think it'll be much better for us to think about embracing technology. And as I like to say for the very last statement, paraphrasing Steve Jobs, stay happy, stay human. Thanks very much for listening. Thanks for your time. Stick around for the panel. And I do want to thank everybody involved in this production.